Thank you. jaren voort met een stuk dat helemaal nieuw voor ons instrument geschreven is. En fait, il n'y a rien qui est écrit pour nos instruments en duo, parce que en fait, les deux instruments ont existé ensemble pendant une centaine d'années, mais personne n'a eu l'idée d'écrire quelque chose pour les deux ensemble. Et nous, on trouve que ça se marie très bien, nous et les instruments. Et on ne joue que des arrangements. On joue que des arrangements, des compositions nouvelles aussi qui ont été écrites pour nous. And the next piece is by Johann Sebastian Bach, Johann Chacon. Actually, if I'm honest, I have to say I never liked the Chacon very much. I hated it. Because it sounds horrible on the violin, I think. And it sounds much better on these two instruments. how did you make an arrangement of the Chacon? Because on the violin, it's very difficult to bring out the harmony and to bring out the lines, because you have to play on four strings at the same time, which is physically impossible. And we can both play, well, at least two notes at the same time, so we get there more or less. So this is our version of Bach's famous Chacon, and I told you I'm going to explain something about the instruments. I'll start with the viola d'amore. La viola d'amour, qui a toujours une tête de femme avec les yeux bandés. Vous savez sans doute pourquoi. Viola d'amour, love is blind. And a lot of people ask us where the name of our ensemble comes from. It's a bit of a silly name. We couldn't find anything better. Suite 17, suite, because Leopold Mozart in his treatise writes that the viola d'amore is the sweetest sounding instrument. And 17, because at that time, our combined strings were in the number of 17. Now we have 18, but when we're going to change the name to suite 18. So that's why. And I'll talk a bit more after the Chacon, if I can still talk after that. Actually, we spend about three quarters of the time tuning and one quarter playing out of tune.
Thank you.
was very good. We met a young composer a couple of years ago at the bass convention in Copenhagen, and we asked him, could you write a piece for us? And he said, yes. And 2 weeks later, the piece was in the mail, and we got the music and we played it through and thought, So we changed the tonality, and we changed the tempo, and we changed the cadence, and we changed just about everything about it. And we made a recording and we sent it to the composer. And I've never read such a mail full of gratitude and happiness. And he said, I never knew my music was so good. he was really so happy with what we did to his music. That's the kind of composer we like. And vous savez que ce concert fait partie, en quelque sorte, de mon doctorat. Je vais pas vous lire mon tout doctorat, le livre là, il y a 500 pages. Mais justement, ça parle de beaucoup de choses, d'authenticité, entre autres. Notre version de la Chaconne n'est peut-être pas authentique, et la façon dont on a joué la pièce moderne, on joue la pièce moderne n'est pas authentique, elle n'est pas fidèle au texte. Mais pour moi, ce n'est pas la chose primordiale. C'est important, mais ce n'est pas si important. Il faut savoir qu'à l'époque baroque, classique, en fait, le compositeur écrivait quelque chose and the performer had to do at least 50% of the work. The composer had confidence that the musician would do right by his music and would play it well and would play it as it had to be played according to some of the rules that we have forgot in the meantime, but also according to his own personal idea. There's a letter by Mozart in which he writes to a singer and he says, I wrote an aria for you. Don't be afraid, it's very long, but it's easier to cut pieces out of it rather than to compose something extra if it's not long enough. So composers kind of took into account that the musician was probably going to do something with or to his music. And that's what we did with this contemporary piece as well. Giuseppe Lupis is not here, he's in America, but this is Codex Lupensis. Just a small thing about the piece itself. When we played it, we felt there's something medieval in the music. There is something, and the title kind of gives it away, Codex Lupensis. It sounds a bit medieval. And not only medieval, but also something Middle Eastern, something Arab we found in this music. And it's maybe a good moment to, excuse me, to explain that the viola d'amore, la viola d'amour, like most of our string instruments, actually originally come from the Middle East. A lot of our string instruments originally come from the Arab world. And some musicologists, less poetic than you and I, say it's la viola del Moor. So the viol of the Moors. But Viola d'Amore is nicer, it's more poetic. But anyway, so just to mention that actually it's an instrument that's Arab in origin. Like the lute, we call it, the lute, it's actually called al-oud in Arab. It's an Arab instrument. I'll talk more about the bass later on, because otherwise we never get to play. So this is Codex Lupensis. We kind of, every time we perform it, we do something else with the cadenza. There's a written cadenza, we played it a couple of times. Sometimes we improvise a cadenza, and today we took actually a little fragment of the sound file that Giuseppe Lupi sent us of the piece, a computer file. We snuck it in, and we also put some Arab colors in, some Arab violin colors in the piece to bring out this flavor. It's not long. If you don't enjoy it, it will be over soon, but I think you'll enjoy it.
By the way, this is the only piece for which we need the music.
We spend a lot of time learning the whole repertoire by heart, because it kind of takes away the barrier between us, or we believe it. takes away the barrier between us and the audience. But there's a little barrier now, but it was a bit too short to run this by heart. Salman? Yes. Thank you. Jean-Baptiste Vanal, mais en fait c'était un compositeur bohémien, si mes souvenirs sont bons. Et de nouveau, on a pris le manuscrit parce qu'il y a plein d'éditions avec plein d'erreurs. On a pris le manuscrit, le facsimile du manuscrit. On a cherché ce qu'il y a dedans, ce qu'on peut comprendre parce qu'il y a quelques raisons de douter sur les articulations. On a cherché tout ça, ça ne vous concerne pas vraiment. Sauf que, en fait, dans cette composition, le compositeur reprend le même matériel mélodique et thématique, mais à chaque fois qu'il reprend, il change d'articulation. Ce sont des choses que j'explique dans mon livre, mais pour le public, disons que pour un musicien, c'est intéressant de chercher ces différences et de les faire sortir. Non seulement, pas spécialement parce que le public va entendre les différences, mais parce que le musicien va ressentir autre chose, donc il va faire sortir autre chose de son instrument, et ça, le public va l'entendre. Donc, petite excursion pseudo-musicologique. C'est un concerto écrit spécifiquement pour cet instrument, pour la contrebasse de masse, pour laquelle il y a beaucoup de littérature soliste à l'époque de Mozart. Parmi les plus ou moins 30 concertos, je pense que celui de Van Halen est un des boucles les plus beaux. And it's a concerto that I started playing about 30 years ago, and if I heard now the way I played it 30 years ago, I think I wouldn't recognize it. And that's the way it should be. We never played the same way either. So tonight there's a little bit of pressure from the jury there. At least two or three of whom know the concerto and play it much better than I do. But just to say that we never played the same way twice. And I'm not sure what's going to come out of the instrument tonight. I'm not sure what we're going to do. Playing a concert for an audience like tonight, the audience has a great influence, in our case at least, a great influence on how we're going to play tonight. If we have an audience that's less warm and less sympathetic than you, we'll probably play very badly. And when we feel the wave of warmth here, we'll try. Let's say this way, let's agree on something. If we play well, it's thanks to you. But if we play badly, we take responsibility. I can't stop talking, I'm sorry. So there's three movements, of course, and normally there's an orchestra. The orchestra is not working today, it's Monday. So Aruko is going to do the orchestra. And it's interesting to know that the soloist in those old concertos, the soloist plays with the orchestra. The soloist plays the tutti's with the orchestra, which is much more interesting than having the soloist like we always see on television. The orchestra starts with the introduction. The soloist is tightening his bow once more and looking at his shoes, and looks like he's waiting for the bus. And it's much more interesting to be involved in the music right from the start and in the interludes and the whole time when I stop playing. So you skip from the orchestra role to the solo role. So in the beginning I'm going to play the tutti bass part and then I switch to solo, etc. And the second movement is, I think, one of the most beautiful second movements in the whole of the bass literature. And I'll try to convey some of the emotions of it. Also, I play three cadenzas. Cadenzas are another subject I can talk 3 hours about. Les cadences, en fait, c'était pour permettre aux solistes de montrer ce qu'ils savaient faire, ce qu'ils ne savaient pas faire. Et les cadences qui sont avec le concerto, qui sont par un grand virtuose de l'époque, Johann Matthias Berg, en fait, les cadences ne sont pas très, très intéressantes. Et ce qui est fascinant, c'est quand on lit les traités de l'époque, Leopold Mozart, Joachim Quantz, etc., Quantz, il écrit quelque part, il a écrit un traité en fait, sur tous les instruments de son époque. Et ce qu'on fait d'habitude, le bassiste, il lit le petit bout sur les basses, et les violistes, il faut lire tout le livre. Et dans le chapitre sur les instruments avant, il parle des cadences. Et il dit qu'en en fait, une bonne cadence, c'est une cadence qu'on peut jouer dans un souffle. In einem Atemzug. And I think that's good advice for string players as well. So we shouldn't play long cadenzas, so they're not really interesting. The only exception is the cadenza of the second movement, which I see as a kind of commentary on what the movement says. The movement tells a story, and the cadenza is like somebody tells the same story in his own words. That's what I try to do with this second cadenza. And should we play now? Okay. Sorry. C'est le problème des cordes en boyau, en fait. Je joue sur des cordes en boyau pour me rendre la vie difficile. Et comme vous avez entendu, ça donne une sonorité plus fragile que les instruments modernes. C'est très fragile dans le son, dans l'attaque. J'adore ça. J'adore la fragilité. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
latter half of the orchestra or the concert following in 5 or 10 minutes. We have to change a couple of things here to kind of create a Japanese atmosphere, because a great part of what we do happens in Japan. We play in schools and hospitals and all kinds of weird places for very small audiences, 20, 30 people. Sometimes, as you may be seen on the screen, in schools, in the gym hall, and sometimes there are 300, 400 kids there, and you don't hear a sound. But usually it's in small venues. So we're just going to prepare a couple of things for the second half. You can stay where you are, or there's nothing here, there's no way to go actually. So bear with us. Still, I want to express my gratitude for having had the chance to play here for over 30 years, and it's been too short. We're in Japan now. We're wearing slippers because no shoes in Japan. sure you can all read what's on the banners. Can you explain?
No, no, please.
This is to say thank you to the customers. Thank you for being patrons of our business. Thank you for coming to the conference. And this is, we buy all kinds of old, interesting books.
Very special.
Special books, yes. Actually, it's not true. I'm getting rid of my books. I gave most of my base books away to one of my ex-students, Michal Bilina. You will hear from him in the years ahead. He's got my whole library. So we're getting rid of stuff. Since we're on the subject of material things and heavy things and getting rid of things, this is a special base. The maker is here, it's Patrick Charton.
Yeah.
He's sitting in the back. The cases actually are the cases that the bases travel in. First, I have this one with a huge case, and then Patrick made a smaller case, and then he tried to make a bass that fit in the case. So he split the instrument in two halves, and you can slide the upper part into the lower part, and the neck into the bass, and it all goes into the small suitcase, which enables us to travel to Japan and to play all around the country. And the reason we started this duo was the disaster in Fukushima a few years ago, and we thought we had to do something, and a musician, apart from playing music, were pretty useless. So what can we do? We can play music, so we started playing music in Belgium, and then we went over there to the Fukushima region. And when we play in Japan, we usually play in schools or in hospitals, or for people who are not used to listening to classical music. And we play arrangements that we make especially for them. And the next little suite is a suite that we play for the children in schools. Sometimes we play for really little kids. Maybe you saw the pictures on the streets. Some of them are 2-3 years old, and from 2-3 years old till adolescence. And the little suite we made consists of what they call warabi uta. Actually, there's a mistake. I thought I understood Japanese, but far from it. Warabi uta doesn't really literally mean game songs, it's children's songs. I confuse with Chinese, where war is to play. That's my excuse. So these are children's songs and a couple of tunes from television programs, kids' programs on television, that the whole of Japan knows. And of course, it was a bit of a risk to play these things here because we don't have the same culture, we don't know the same songs. But maybe you can find it in your hearts and in your memories, the time when you were a kid and you danced and you had these little songs. And we made a suite out of it, and of course, nous venons de l'opéra, on n'a pas résisté à mettre un leitmotiv dedans. Le leitmotiv, c'est le titre de la suite, Moïkai. En fait, c'est un jeu de cache-cache. Et Moïkai, ça veut dire, est-ce que je peux déjà me tourner? Et la réponse est Madadayo, pas encore. Et comme vous pouvez lire, on voulait jouer ça à Fukushima, on nous a déconseillé parce que justement, les gens qui habitaient, qui ont été évacués, ne pouvaient pas rentrer à la maison. Donc, on nous a déconseillé d'utiliser ce titre parce que c'était un peu trop tôt après l'accident. Donc on a ça comme petit thème, et la toute dernière chanson, ça commence avec les cloches qui sonnent dans toutes les écoles du Japon et qu'on entend dans les rues parce qu'en fait il y a des haut-parleurs partout et on entend la fin de l'école. Et la chanson, la dernière chanson, c'est la chanson qui indique que c'est la fin de la journée de l'école. Donc en fait une petite suite qui décrit une journée à l'école. Les chansons enfantines, et si vous reconnaissez quelque chose, Christian, alors. Voilà. Au Japon, ils chantent avec nous. Ici, il y a Jérôme dans la salle. Jérôme. Jérôme, c'est mon archétype qui fabrique des archives fantastiques comme celui-ci. Jérôme, lève-toi. C'est un archétype extraordinaire. En plus, c'est l'homme le plus gentil du monde. Il y a plein d'hommes le plus gentils du monde. Les dames, sans oublier les hommes. Il n'y a que des gens gentils ici, c'est là que beaucoup. Quand on joue ça, même ici, il est un peu difficile à retenir les larmes parce qu'il y a tellement de souvenirs au Japon, dans les régions dévastées, où les gens ont peur d'être oubliés par le monde. Et c'est ce qui se passe, bien sûr, parce que la catastrophe, c'était il y a quelques années, mais pour nous, c'est fini, mais ce n'est pas fini, bien sûr. Hein. Ce ne sera pas fini avant quelques centaines d'années. Donc voilà, on y retourne régulièrement. Et on joue donc pour les enfants, pour les personnes âgées. Et ça nous plaît beaucoup. Voilà. Et il y a un lien avec, c'est peut-être important de le souligner puisque c'est dans le cadre d'un doctorat. There is a link very strong between what we do in Japan and ancient music. Everything I learned in the ancient music department and I learned so much in my head is too small for everything I was taught there, and I learned so much there, and I learned to play on these strange instruments with gus strings and frets and funny looking bows and things that only make life really much easier for a musician, just make it a bit harder. But as you heard tonight, these old instruments have a different, not only have a different sound quality, but they force the musician to play in a different way. And that different way, for me at least, goes in the direction of something that speaks to you, I hope, to my audiences in general. It's a sound quality that's fragile, that's not as solid as a modern instrument, and it's very close to the human voice for me, and it allows me to almost fall down, and I like that feeling. I'm not sure if I'm going to make it tonight. I'm not sure if the next note is going to come. And I'm not sure, and I like that because it puts me on the same footing as you are. We're all fragile, and in today's world, I think it's not a bad idea to admit from time to time that we're fragile. That was the speech for tonight. We go on with the music from yesterday, because ancient music is music from yesterday. I could talk for hours about ancient music because it's something that fascinates me, and I'm not going to do that to you. But this is some more music from yesterday, and sometimes it's nice to live in the past, but it's very nice to be here tonight as well with ancient music and music from long ago and from not very long ago. And if you recognize the next piece or couple of pieces, don't be afraid to sing along. Show you're fragile.
Thank you.
Merci, j'espère que vous avez reconnu. When I'm 64, for me, that's in 2 years, I'm around 62. I'm happy to be alive. So, we go back to Japan a little bit with the film music, you know, Japanese anime. A lot of people here know them, but a lot of people we found don't know them at all. Know the Kiki la Sorcière, Kiki's Delivery Service in English. Totoro, my neighbor Totoro. Ponyo. Ponyo is about a little fish, and in the film the little fish's name is Brunhild. it starts with Wagner, and the fish's name is actually Brunhild, but she's called Ponyo. So, doesn't ring a bell anywhere. It's maybe some Japanese people, they know that, yes. If you want, you can sing along. But there are absolutely fabulous in Japan, and whenever we play these, everybody sings along. Well, 1, 2, 3, maybe 3 people can sing along. It's better than that. It's very nice music. Actually, it's interesting, the composer is Joe Hisaishi. And Joe Hisaishi started as a composer of ultra-contemporary music. I won't give you an example. But the kind of screechy and hitting the instrument and all kinds of weird intervals and stuff. Really contemporary music. And then one day he saw the light and he thought, I'm going to make music for anime films. And his music is really wonderful. And a couple of years ago he wrote, il a créé un concerto pour contrebasse. Et j'étais très content parce que je pensais ça va être dans le style de Ponyo et Totoro, mais non, it's again in the contemporary style. So I'm not going to bother anymore. Or maybe, later, after my pension. So, a little suite. I don't know if you have the order of the pieces in the program. That's the first one. The first one is Ponyo. Ponyo is about a fish. So for those who don't know Ponyo, we put some European fish in it, which you might recognize. And then we have Totoro and then Kiki. Yes. Enjoy. Thank you. very hard to play. So this double bass is the second one that Patrick Chartrand built for me. Now I'm going to the first one, and I'll put this one down first. It's easy, it's all automatic. When you study bass, you have 5 years. First year, one string. Second year, two strings. Until you get to 5 strings. So this is a piece for the first year. Paganini, qui a écrit cette pièce, c'était un grand virtuose, un grand violoniste, c'était aussi un grand voyou qui se trouvait en prison de temps en temps. Il commençait un casino qui faisait faillite, des choses comme ça. Donc il se trouvait en prison de temps en temps. Mais il pouvait amener son violon. Donc il faisait du violon 12 heures par jour en plus, jusqu'à ce que les gardiens l'avaient jusqu'à là. Et comme il jouait sur des cordes en baillon, les cordes cassaient une par une, jusqu'à ce qu'il ne restait qu'une corde, et le gardien était très content. Il disait, ça va être fini maintenant. But he wrote a piece for the one string that was left. And that's the piece we're going to try and play for you tonight. And since Patrick Chartrand is such a generous violin maker, you know, I go to him with crazy ideas. And usually when you go to a violin maker with some crazy ideas, that's impossible, you know, because they're so classical, they're so... But he goes like, how am I going to do that? He doesn't say no, he's already thinking, he's already one step further than me. So I said, I want a bass just to play Paganini on one string. Because I love my colleagues, my bass playing colleagues, I love them. They're a happy bunch and they're warm, very warm people. And I love bass players, really. Most people love bass players, I think. Because they're down to earth, really, literally. But some of them, when they play the piece, I see that from time to time they go to the second string. What's the point of the piece? I mean, it's not a great piece. The only thing about it is you have to play it on one string. So my son last week said, you know, the next challenge is to play it on one string with one finger, but I'm not there. this is the great thing about these basses of Chartrand is you can take off the head and the tail is the next stage, but you take off the head and you could put on another head with 4 or 5 strings, whatever. So he made a special head with one string for me. Thank you, Patrick. Okay, I keep talking because I'm afraid to play. Okay, what do I have to do? Okay, coraggio. Thank you for being here tonight. It was fantastic. Such a great audience. I told you it's not a concert like you're used to attend, but I hope you liked it a little bit. We did, anyway. Thank you so much. Here is an attempt at Paganini.
Thank you. Thank you.
the last time I go back to Japan. In a couple of years, it's going to be for the last time because I would love to live there. I just have to convince her. She's almost there, 75%. When we play in Japan, there is one song that all the grown-ups in the room know because there's a television series and a series of television films about Dora-san, he's called. And he's an incredibly popular figure. The movies are very, very touching. They're really movies because they move you. When we play this, I wear my hat because the figure in the film wears a hat. And I put on my hat and she plays the first couple of notes and all the Kleenexes come out because not one eye stays dry. We're not counting on that tonight, but this is the tune of this series is called Futen. And what is Futen?
Man without roots.
A man without roots. So Futen, Tora-san.